saved my soul. It's different now, since by his blood I'm whole. Oh, Satan had to flee when Jesus rescued me. Now it's different. Oh, stand and sing the chorus, will you please sing? Sing. It's different. Jesus rescued me. Now it's different. Oh, so different now. I had Mickey going to take the mic over to Brother Kenneth, ask God's blessing on the remainder of our service.
Just as well, you've kept us safe. And Father, you are the almighty ruler of the universe, and we tell you that with all sincerity. You're in control, and we pray, Father, as we meet here this morning, as we finish the service, as Lee brings a message, that you'll give him physical strength, that you'll help him with the message that we need to hear. And we'd just like to say one more time, Father, we are certainly grateful to you for taking care of your people. In Christ's name, I pray this. Amen.
Amen. You can be seated. Just before Brother Lee comes, we're going to sing... A song we did early on in the drive-in service, and I know you'll be blessed by this song. Allie's going to sing the verses, and it's called Walk Me Through. I love the message in this song. I hope it'll bless you.
There's a storm on the horizon, walk me through. As I face the fear and danger, walk me through. When the darkness hovers near and I lose sight of the truth, take my hand, gentle shepherd, walk me through. Walk me through. When all hope has turned to sorrow, walk me through. When I grow too weak to stand and I don't know what to do, carry me, O faithful Father. Walk me through. Walk me through.
Well, we pray for the Lord to do that, and I suspect all of us can say from experience that we have known Him already to do that. I want to review some things with you this morning. I want to talk briefly about what we believe. What do we believe, anyhow? You must believe something, or you would still be in bed on Sunday morning, probably, or at the breakfast table, or somewhere besides getting ready and coming to church. What do we believe? And why do we believe what we believe? I want to read some scripture from 2 Peter and then a couple of verses from 2 Timothy this morning, if you'd like to turn there. 2 Peter chapter 1, starting with verse 16 down through 21 for beginning. 2 Peter 1:16. Peter writes, "We have not followed cunningly devised fables when we made known unto you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of His majesty. For He received from God the Father honor and glory when there came such a voice to Him from the excellent glory, 'This is My beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased.' And this voice, which came from heaven, we heard when we were with Him in the Holy Mount. We have also," Peter says, "a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto you do well that you take heed, as unto a light that shineth in a dark place, until the day dawn and the day star arise in your hearts. Knowing this first, that no prophecy of the Scripture is of any private interpretation, for the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Ghost." Now let's look into 2 Timothy chapter 3, just two verses. Verses 16 and 17. Paul writes to the young preacher Timothy, "All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works." Why do we believe what we believe? Let me answer it real briefly before I answer it at some length. Because the Old Testament and the New Testament are the Word of God. Amen. And having said that, we could say amen and go home. I hope I don't ruin that. But let's keep in mind that we believe that the Old and New Testament are the inspired Word of God. They were written by holy men, selected by God, to whom He revealed His Word, and they are inspired. That means they are infused with the breath of God. He breathed His Word to the men who wrote it down. I want to use a couple of word, at least one word this morning briefly that I don't suppose any of us have used in a casual conversation this past week. When we talk about what we believe about the Scripture, we say that we believe in the plenary verbal inspiration of God. How many have used the word plenary recently? Neither have I. After this morning, I shan't again for no telling how long. Do we know what it means when we say that we believe in that kind of inspiration? It means that we believe in the complete inspiration of the Bible, the complete inspiration of the Word of God. And we believe that it is all equally inspired. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. We believe that. But we believe also that we can go to the end of the book of Revelation when it talks about the Lord coming back again. and John saying, "Even so, come quickly, Lord Jesus," that was inspired as well. And verbal inspiration means that we believe that actually the words were inspired. Not just the thoughts, but the very words of God. We believe that the Scripture, both the Old and the New Testament, are inerrant. That means we believe that there are not any mistakes in the inspired work of God, Word of God. No mistakes in it. But we go a step further than that, and we say we believe it to be infallible. And that means not only are there no mistakes there, but there is not the possibility of an error in the Word of God. Now let's let that sink in for just a moment. Those are pretty strong statements to make, that we believe that the inspiration of God's Word is complete, all of it's equally inspired, that the very words were inspired by God, that there are no errors in the book, and that there's not a possibility of an error in the book as it was originally given to mankind. Now, there can be mistakes in translation, and there certainly are errors in interpretation. If I read a passage of Scripture and want to cast it in my light, I can surely make mistakes. But as it was given to us, there's not. Now, why do we believe these things? We'll spend a little time on this, and I'll try to be relatively brief this morning. Why do we believe these things? Well, number one, as we mentioned a little while ago, because of our own subjective experiences, we believe that the Word of God, the Old and New Testaments, were inspired by Him. Through our own subjective experiences that we've had. And after we pass through this coronavirus thing and it's all behind us, and pray God that will happen, amen, that it'll be behind us one day, we'll be able to look back and say, we've experienced God's blessings in difficult times and He's helped us through it. Amen. We believe these things also because of fulfilled prophecy. I want to look at a few of those for just a little bit. There's an interesting prophecy in the Old Testament about a Persian ruler named Cyrus. You know where I'm going? Isaiah said in chapter 21 that Babylon would fall. And then he said that Babylon would fall to the Medes and the Persians. Babylon was a mighty power at the time. And then he said that Babylon, while it would fall to the Medes and Persians, would be conquered by a man named Cyrus. The problem is that Cyrus had not been born. And he was not born for about 150 years after the prophecy was made. But not only did Isaiah predict that Cyrus would overthrow Babylon, but he wrote that he would be Jehovah God's anointed and His shepherd. Now, he was a pagan. He was a heathen. He was not a believer, as we would consider it. But Isaiah prophesied that it would be Cyrus who would release the Jews from captivity and help them return to Jerusalem and rebuild the temple. And that was written almost 200 years before Cyrus conquered Babylon. And it's not a fairy tale, because secular history tells us that these things did actually happen after they'd been prophesied. There was a man named Cyrus. He ruled the Medo-Persian Empire. He conquered Babylon, and he assisted the Jews in going home and in rebuilding the temple. Well, we believe because of another fulfilled prophecy, a whole handful of other fulfilled prophecies about the nation of Israel. One of those was that Israel would prevail over her enemies. Isaiah in chapter 41 prophesied that. He said God would help Israel during times of conflict with her enemies. Now, during this time, the northern tribes or Israel were already under the heel of the Assyrians, and Judah was about to fall to Babylon. And it didn't look like that could possibly happen. Isaiah said, she'll be victorious. But if we come all the way forward through centuries of history to our time, we find out that in 48, Israel, discounted by everybody, became a nation over in the Middle East. And since then, she's been attacked by much bigger countries and has triumphed in all those wars. I'd say that's prophecy fulfilled. Here's one we don't think about it. I like this. The prophecy was that trees would grow again in Israel. Isaiah prophesied the restoration of Israel. And that's happened in modern times. Israel's a dry land. There is a lack of water there in all that area. And it had become a desolate, desert-like area for a long time. Unproductive. You couldn't grow anything agriculturally there for a couple of thousand years. But early, 120 years or so ago, in the early 1900s, Jewish people started coming back to Israel, and they built up the land, and they constructed a network of irrigation systems, and they watered the land, and it became productive again. Isaiah prophesied that Israel's fruit would fill the world. Israel had no fruit. Israel, as he said, was a dry and barren land. But Isaiah prophesied that one day Israel would blossom and would fill the world with fruit, with food and with fruit. And it's been at least partially fulfilled, because today the land of Israel, which had been barren for centuries, is a leading producer of agricultural products, and they export food to other countries around the world. When we were there years ago, we'd meet big open trucks like we meet today that have corn silage in them in the fog, taken to farmers to put in their silos. But that kind of a big open truck piled high with oranges from the area of Joppa. They call it Jaffa. And they referred to those oranges as Jaffas because there were so many of them produced there. And they would haul them by the truckloads to the shipyards and ship them across the Mediterranean to other countries. He even prophesied, Isaiah did, that Israel's deserts would become like the Garden of Eden. Isaiah 51:3 for the reference if you'd like to read it. He said, Israel, the prophet said, Israel would be restored and made like a paradise. And I wish you could see it. They've done things there that I don't understand. You don't grow anything in salt water or too close to a body of salt water. That's my understanding. And yet, When we came down in the plain to land near the Dead Sea, there were huge stacks of hay for the dairy farms that were along there. They'd bale it up in these, Tad, I can't remember what you call them, that make, looks like hay bales, only they're great massive. What do you call those wagons that they do that? Anybody? Rex, you remember what the stack wagons are? Let's call them that, okay? Nobody knows any different. And they bring the hay in and stack it right along the banks of the Dead Sea. And you could see the salt water not far out, and then the hay, and then the productive farms a little further back. And you wouldn't think that would be possible, or I wouldn't think that would be possible. And then another thing we saw, that we think of this dry, barren desert land, but then every once in a while there would be huge swampy areas with mosquitoes, healthy as could be, that would drive the people away. And they tried to drain the swamps, and they did, but some of them, there was no place to drain them to, and no way to do it. And they tried to figure out, how can we reclaim this swampland? And they brought in eucalyptus trees and planted around and then in the swampy areas. And those trees drank up the swamp water, and they could get in and farm the land, and it was some of the richest that there was. The Sea of Galilee has been channeled to irrigate, and parts of Israel is blooming like a rose. And they've planted trees. The last I read, more than 200 million trees had been planted in what was the desert area, and it was becoming more of a non-desert area, a treed area, a forested area, a green area, and more rainfall was coming. They're planting trees all the time. I planted one of them. There's a lee tree over there somewhere. Don't have any idea. But fulfilled prophecy helps us to believe what we do believe in. And then there's another reason. And it's enough for a lot of people, and that is Jesus said it was going to happen. Jesus said so. So why do we believe these things? And then given that we do because of these reasons, how can we meaningfully affirm our stand on the truth of the Scriptures? How can we affirm in a way that people will know that we mean business about what we think about the Bible? Well, I'm going to be really brief here, but this is important. Number one, tell it. Let people know what we believe about the Word of God. Let our friends know, let our family know, let the church know that we don't come just because we got a new pair of shoes to wear and show off. Let the church know that we come because we believe what we hear here. Let our classes at school or wherever they may be know. Let the place where we work know that we are a believer. How do we do that? Well, we tell it, but we show it as well by the way that we live. And that's one of the strongest ways we have of affirming the stand that we take in regard to God's holy word. Tell it and then show it. And then we need to read the book. I can take my... This thing started falling apart on me last night. Some of it fell out. It's kind of worn around the edges. I've got other Bibles, but I like this one. And I can't find one like it anymore. Have you got an old favorite Bible? Anybody? One that you like? Okay, I see some hands. And I like this one. But you know, I could take it home and lay it up on a shelf. And I do. I've got a place on my bookcase on the top shelf where I lay it. That's where I keep it. I keep one that's a little better in my desk drawer, but this is the one I like, and I put it on the bookcase. I could take this home, Brother Steve, I could put it on the bookcase and leave it there and never touch it, and it wouldn't do me a whole lot of good. You understand? We need to read the book. We need to read it. And then we need to do what it says to do. And then we need to tell others about it. Somebody, I didn't make this up, I like it. Somebody said we need to read it, we need to heed it, and we need to feed it. I like that. Why? Well, because this book that we believe and that we are supposed to practice, this book that tells us the truth. The reason we need to do this is this book tells us that Jesus is coming again. Doesn't tell us when, but it says he'll be back someday. And everybody needs to be ready for that. God bless you. Anyone have a word? Father, dismiss us in your care and keeping. Help us through the week ahead. Help us to read your word and heed it and feed it to others. Help us to share our faith. Help us to do what you want us to do. We pray in Christ's name. The Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace.
Would you stand? We're going to close with this song Lawanda's playing. This will be our dismissal, all right? Thank you for coming this morning. We'll see you next Sunday. Sing the chorus. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him. Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for